talking about the second angel's message. And today on this second part of the second angel's message, we want to begin by talking about the first call to come out of Babylon. The first call to come out of Babylon. I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to Genesis chapter 12, and we're going to read verses 1 through 4. Now the Lord said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, into a land that I will shew thee, and I will make of thee a great nation, and I will bless thee, and make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing, and I will bless them that bless thee, and curse him that curses thee, and in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. So Abram departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and Lot went with him, and Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Now this is the first call in the Bible to come out of Babylon. Abraham didn't have a map. He didn't have any GPS that was going to take him to the promised land. He didn't have pictures, a pictorial representation of what it was going to look like when he got there. He had no reports of this good land ahead, but by faith, based in the Word of God, he departed. And he left Ur the Chaldeans in the land of Shinar. Now, did Abraham say, and I just want you to think about this for a minute. Did Abraham say, I think I'll wait until the church starts keeping Sunday before I leave? Or I'll wait until the church leadership totally apostatizes. Now, in this call in Genesis 12, there are three distinct portions to it. Abraham was to first, he was to leave his country, he was to leave his kindred, and then more specifically, he was to leave his father's house. Now, we might not leave our country today. Most of us who are hearing my voice, at least today, before we publish the recording, are hearing me from the United States, most. And probably we're not going to leave the United States, I said most. But we are not to be apart, friends, of the political sphere of our countries. Because these really aren't our countries. Paul says our citizenship is in heaven. And Jesus says, my kingdom is not of this world. And it's time, friends, it's time now for God's people to dissolve the corporations with the government and quit asking for and accepting favors from the government. Do you know what I mean when I say to dissolve the corporations? You know, a corporation is a legal agreement between two entities. And whenever we have what we would today call a 501c3 church, that's a corporation that has that is an agreement formed between the church and the state, based upon the state's permission to allow it to exist. By the very fact that a church is incorporated like that, they have asked the state for permission to exist in such form, and the state has given them that permission. And therefore, the state is being the master over the church. And we today are to quit those kind of corporations. We're to leave behind our church families if necessary, our brothers and sisters and our kindred, if they refuse, friends, to advance in truth. And finally, Abraham had to leave his father's immediate family or his immediate house. And it wasn't until Abraham, as we read on, it wasn't until Abraham had made this separation that God showed him the promised land. Abraham left Ur, and then Terah, his father, died, and then because of strife between the herdsmen of Lot and the herdsmen of Abraham, Lot left for the Jordan Valley. And after that, in Genesis 13, in our next slide, verses 14 and 15, it says, and the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot was separated from him, lift up now thine eyes, and look from the place where thou art northward and southward, and eastward and westward, for all the land which thou seest to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. It wasn't until Abraham had met the conditions that God had given to him that he showed him or expressed to him the promised land. And friends, we are looking for a heavenly Canaan, aren't we?
Amen.
And yet, if we fail to heed the call that God gives us, I promise you we will not get to sit and stand and dwell in that great promised land. Abraham couldn't receive the promises until he was all the way out, and neither will we receive the promise until we are willing to come all the way out of Babylon. We are not given the option of just coming out part of the way. We are to come fully out. In Selected Messages, in our next slide, book 3, page 203, Ellen White says, "Those who are truly sanctified will reverence and obey the word of God as fast as it is opened to them, and they will express a strong desire to know what is truth on every point of doctrine." Do you think that includes the second angel's message? Does it include the fourth angel's message? I believe it does. It's pretty clear. It says that they will express a strong desire to know what is truth on every point of doctrine. Now, God does make a call. God makes several calls, but makes calls for his people to come out of Babylon. And why does he do this, beloved? We need to understand that God is a holy God, right? He's a holy God. And if we are going to be in his presence forever, beloved, we must be holy, because if we were to stand in the presence of God now and our characters are not perfected yet, his presence would be as a consuming fire. In fact, the Bible says that our God is a consuming fire. And to those without the righteous robe of Christ, his presence is a consuming fire. And he wants us to be holy like he is. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 15 and 16, 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 15 and 16. "But as he which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy." And of course, Peter's quoting there, you know, from the Old Testament, and that we're to be holy. And he says, in all manner of conversation, and that word conversation in King James English meant lifestyle, in all that you do. That's what the word means in the Greek. And Ellen White just said this, and I like this. I think this is so sublime. It's so simple. And she wrote this first. It first appeared in the Southern Watchman of June 11, 1903, paragraph 7. And it was later reprinted in the Review and reprinted in Signs of the Times. But it just says this: holiness is constant agreement with God. Do you want to be holy? Do you want to know what holiness is? It means that you are in constant agreement with God. I think that's just so beautiful. So if we're going to be holy, friends, we have to be in constant agreement with him. God is holy, and he desires those who were made in his image. After all, Genesis 1:26, we were made in the image of God. He wants us to be holy. But beloved, I tell you a truth. You cannot be clean if you live where the pigs are. Isn't that right? You can't go stay where the pigs are and be clean. That's just a very fundamental principle that we know as humanity. And the pig loves to wallow in the mud. And God desires for his people is to be clean, not to be dirty. In Numbers chapter 23, next slide, and verse 9. Numbers 23, verse 9. Here, the desire of God is expressed by Balaam as he was making the prophetic pronouncements about Israel. And he says, "From the top of the rocks I see him, and from the hills I behold him. Lo, the people shall dwell alone and shall not be reckoned among the nations." Jesus said that we were to be in the world but not of the world. Isn't that right? And friends, you cannot associate with the ungodly without being affected by it. And there's a place to witness, friends, but so oftentimes we just mix and mingle where we shouldn't be. And especially is this true in our worship. We think that somehow we are safe to go where error is being preached without being sent there. But friends, in those situations, the angels of God cannot keep you. The Apostle Paul, writing to the church at Corinth in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 14 through 16, wrote this: Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers. For what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part hath he that believeth with an infidel? And what agreement hath the temple of God with idols? For ye are the temple of the living God. As God hath said, I dwell in them, and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. But he doesn't stop there, does he? There's more. Look at the next two verses, verses 17 and 18. Wherefore, come out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you, and I will be a father unto you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters, saith the Lord Almighty. He says that if we come out, what will he do? He will receive us. But do we get to receive the promise without meeting the condition? What is it when we claim the promises of God without meeting the conditions? What do we call that? Presumption. That's presumption, isn't it? And so it's presumptuous for us, beloved, to think that we can be received of God, that we're going to be taken into his kingdom, if we fail to heed these calls to come out from among the ungodly and the wicked. And you might say, well, Brother Allen, how can you say that these other churches are ungodly or that they're wicked or that God wants you to come out of them? I can say because God says it. God says it. Turn with me to Revelation chapter 18. And we'll look at this text at another day, but I just want to emphasize this right now. Revelation chapter 18, verse 2. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen. And that's what we read in Revelation chapter 14, 8. Babylon is fallen, right? That's the second angel's message. And here it's repeated by the fourth angel. And then it says, and has become the habitation of what? Saints? Mother Teresa's, John Paul II's, St. Athanasius. It says it's become the habitation of devils and the hold of every foul spirit and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Friend, God wants to dwell in holy, clean people. And if we don't come out of Babylon, we're going to become like Babylon. Because, friends, that is what we are beholding. In 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18, we know the principle is that by beholding, we become changed. And sadly, the professed state of the church today is one of wickedness. The Apostle Paul, writing to Timothy in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 4, says, This know also, that in the last days, perilous times shall come. Paul's not writing about his own days. He's writing about the last days. He says, in the last days, perilous times shall come. He says, for men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection. We see so much of that today, don't we? Truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. And you say, well, you know, Alan, that just sounds just like Hollywood, doesn't it? Sounds like he's describing Hollywood to us. And this might sound like a list of the sins of the inhabitants of New York, San Francisco, or Las Vegas. But as we notice what verse 5, Paul is saying, this is what's going on in the professed church of God. He says, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. All these things he mentions in verses 1, 2, 3, and 4, he says, these are all from those who profess godliness. They claim to be Christian. But he says, from such, turn away. Does God mean it or not? Does God mean what he says? These people are professed Christians. They're the professed people of God. And as in the Council of Corinth, the command is to turn away from them and to disassociate from the world. Now, friends, let's be careful in this. We have a witness, and we're not to leave our witness behind. We are to truly let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify our Father which is in heaven. We are not to treat the world nor worldly church as something that has a contaminating plague that can never be touched without defilement. We are in the world, but we're not of the world. But friends, we must balance witness and association. We do not worship in Catholic churches so that we can witness to the people, do we? Instead, we find other ways to share our faith with them in the streets or in their homes, etc. We don't go to strip joints and houses of prostitutions to save the hookers. There are better ways that God accepts. And that, friends, is also true concerning those who profess to be the people of God. Now, it's true that there are times that God sends special men to do a special witness, such as when Paul visited the synagogues. Yet this is not the normal pattern for us today. We have this counsel from early writings, and I alluded to this earlier. Early writings, page 124 and 125. It says, God is displeased with us when we go to listen to error without being obliged to go for, unless he sends us to those meetings where error is forced home to the people by the power of the will. He will not keep us. He will not keep us. Friends, God means what he says. We're all responsible for ourselves, friends. God has a gospel order. He works through leaders, and that is right. But historically, it is the leaders of God's people that have been the ones who have led those people into error. For example, Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 16. God says, "For the leaders of this people caused them to err, and they that are led of them are destroyed." We're all going to have to stand for ourselves. We're going to be responsible for ourselves. But the great blame will be upon the leaders. In Jeremiah chapter 15, verse 6, he says, "My people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have caused them to go astray." And sometimes pastors say things that aren't popular. Sometimes they have to say things that don't come across so smoothly. And people wonder why the pastors sometimes have to say what they say. But friends, if we're going to be faithful to God, we can't let the sheep go astray without a warning. We can't just give them the things that they want to hear. As Paul says, preachers, you know, teaching things to people who have itching ears. God is sounding a warning in the second and fourth angels' messages. And if we fail to listen, friends, we cannot blame the pastors or leaders for our downfall, though. In Ezekiel chapter 14, verse 20, he says, "Though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, saith the Lord God, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter, they shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness." Ezekiel chapter 14, verse 20. Yeah. Now, you've seen pictures, you've seen the analogy of that great large bird, flightless bird, the ostrich, and putting its head in the ground, you know, trying to play, and we call that today playing ostrich, where you don't want to be held responsible. You don't want to know, so therefore you won't be held responsible. But limited knowledge is not enough. I'd like to just share with you a statement from Gospel Workers on page 251. "As the worker studies the life of Christ and the character of his mission is dwelt upon, each fresh search will reveal something more deeply interesting than has yet been unfolded. The subject is inexhaustible. The study of the incarnation of Christ, his atoning sacrifice and mediatorial work will employ the mind of the diligent student as long as time shall last, and looking to heaven with its unnumbered years, he will exclaim, 'Great is the mystery of godliness.'" And then she continues. We talk about the first angel's message and the second angel's message, and we think we have some understanding of the third angel's message, but as long as we are content with a limited knowledge, we shall be disqualified to obtain clear views of truth. So you see, friends, God calls us each to be a student, to study this and to dig deep, because if we are content with a limited knowledge, then we will be disqualified. Now, knowledge of itself won't save us. We won't be saved without knowledge, though, however, either. Hosea 4:6, "My people are destroyed for" what? Lack of knowledge. It's through a knowledge of God that the promises of his word, that we are to be, through the promises of his word, that we are to become a partaker of the divine nature, 2 Peter chapter 1, 2, and 3. And as one carefully studies the three angels' messages, it becomes apparent that these messages are really about God and his character. All of these messages are still important today. In fact, we've been told, friends, that there's no third angel's message without first having the first and second angel's messages. In Selected Messages, Book 2, pages 104 and 105, we read this. "The first and second messages were given in 1843 and 1844, and we are now under the proclamation of the third. But all three of the messages are still to be proclaimed. It is just as essential now as ever before that they shall be repeated to those who are seeking for the truth. By pen and voice, we are to sound the proclamation, showing their order and the application of the prophecies that bring us to the third angel's message. There cannot be a third without the first and second. See, some people want to teach and preach the first angel's message, and that's good. We like that. And then there's some people that want to scoot on ahead to the third angel's message. But she says, you really can't do that. It doesn't work without both the first and the second angel's messages. And the proclamation of these messages is, friends, a very solemn work for us. It's the most solemn work ever given to mortals. In fact, I'd like to just share this statement with you. This is from Manuscript Release, Volume 7, page 107. She says, the most solemn, sacred work ever given to mortals is the proclamation of the first, second, and third angel's messages to our world. And you thought it was probably to live during the time of Pentecost when Peter was preaching. Or maybe it was a time just before that when the disciples were walking with Jesus. Or maybe the greatest time to live was when Moses led the children of Israel out of Egypt and they saw the Red Sea open. But she says, the most solemn and sacred work ever given to mortals was to be here at this time and to give this message now. Isn't that something? I tell you, friends, you're privileged. You're privileged to live right now. I think of Dr. Martin Luther King. He was speaking one day and he said he got to thinking, and if God had given him a choice to live at any time period in the history of the earth, when would he have liked to have lived? And he went through several different scenarios of, you know, maybe being with the children of Israel when they came out of Egypt and seeing the Red Sea open, and maybe being there with Martin Luther during the time of the Reformation. But in King's day, he said, the time I'd like to live, he says, is in the latter part of the 20th century, just when he did live. But as great as Dr. King's purpose and goals were, we have a greater goal. We have a far greater goal and a greater mission. Today, there is much confusion about how the Seventh-day Adventist Church fits into the picture of Babylon. Is it still God's church? Is this corporation, is this 501c3 corporation who has headquarters in Silver Springs, Maryland, is it still the anointed of God? Is it an apostasy? Or is it apostate? Let's begin by noting a lesson from the Bible. Jeremiah had given a prophecy that was considered of great value to the Jews, and we read it in Jeremiah chapter 31. So I'd like to invite you to Jeremiah chapter 31. And we're going to start in verse 35. Jeremiah 31, verse 35. Thus saith the Lord, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinance of the moon and of the stars for a light by night, which divideth the sea when the waves thereof roar, the Lord of hosts is his name. And then verse 36, if those ordinances depart from before me, saith the Lord, then the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me forever. Verse 37, thus saith the Lord, if heaven above can be measured and the foundations of the earth searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel for all that they have done, saith the Lord. Well, that sounds pretty foolproof, doesn't it? I mean, for the Jewish people, that just sounds like we've got a ticket that's been punched all the way through to Glory Land. As long as the sun was rising and setting, as long as the moon was going through its phases, as long as the waves, you know, the tides were coming in and going out, he says, as long as that happens, he says, Israel will be a nation before me forever. Well, how do you argue with that? In the book, Christ Object Lessons, on page 294, she said, the Jewish people cherished the idea that they were the favorites of heaven. Do you know of anyone else who thinks that way, by the way? Mm-hmm. The Jewish people cherished the idea that they were the favorites of heaven and that they were always to be exalted as the church of God. They were the children of Abraham, they declared, and so firm did the foundation of their prosperity seem to them that they defied earth and heaven to dispossess them of their rights. By their lives of unfaithfulness, they were preparing for the condemnation of heaven and for separation from God. When Jesus left the temple for the last time, he said in Matthew 23:38, he says, "Behold, your house is left unto you desolate." When he had cleansed the temple the first time, he said, "You've made my house a house of merchandise." But now it's not his house anymore. It's not his father's house. It's their house. And you can be sure that when he did that, those rabbis and those scribes, those Pharisees and Sadducees, all those different groups, they got together and they said, "Look," as they spoke to the people, "Look, don't worry about this guy. I know that there are problems. We realize that there's, you know, a little apostasy here or there, but we have this promise in Jeremiah 31, and we're going through. The ship appears about ready to sink, but it doesn't. You go through with the ship." That's what they were thinking. And they declared Jesus Christ to be an imposter and a fraud, because after all, the word of God cannot be broken. We're people of the book. We stand on the book. And this is what inspiration says. But there were two things that the Jewish people missed. One was within the prophecy of Jeremiah 31. And that was the promise of verses 35 and through 37 was to a people. According to verse 33, it was to a people in whose heart his law was written. In other words, there was a condition for this prophecy to be fulfilled. The people had to have the law of God written in their hearts. And if God's law had been written in their hearts, they would have never lost the favor of God, and they would have never tried to have killed the Son of God. Because the commandment says, "Thou shalt not kill." The Jews also failed to remember the words of another prophecy found in Daniel chapter 9, verse 24, where it says, 70 weeks are determined upon thy people. Now, while it may have appeared on the surface that the Jews were promised the kingdom no matter what had transpired, the truth is that they were accountable to truth. And there's a lesson for Adventism in this. In Christ Object Lessons, again, on page 295 and through to 296, it says this: Christ would have averted the doom of the Jewish nation if the people had received him. But envy and jealousy made them implacable. They determined that they would not receive Jesus of Nazareth as the Messiah. They rejected the light of the world, and thenceforth their lives were surrounded with darkness as the darkness of midnight. The doom foretold came upon the Jewish nation. Their own fierce passions, uncontrolled, wrought their ruin. In their blind rage, they destroyed one another. Their rebellious, stubborn pride brought upon them the wrath of their Roman conquerors. Jerusalem was destroyed, the temple laid in ruins, and its site plowed like a field. The children of Judah perished by the most horrible forms of death. Millions were sold to serve as bondmen in heathen lands. And then she says, as a people, the Jews had failed of fulfilling God's purpose, and the vineyard was taken from them. The privileges they had abused, the work they had slighted, was entrusted to others. And now notice these faithful words, friends. The parable of the vineyard applies not alone to the Jewish nation. It has a lesson for us. The church in this generation has been endowed by God with great privileges and blessings, and he expects corresponding returns. When she says that he expects corresponding returns, that means that the more blessings, the more he expects back. The more truth he bestows, the more he expects back. The more he bestows, the higher the standard and the greater the responsibility that we will be held for. And that includes us sitting right here. Don't think it doesn't for a minute. Now, concerning of our study of the testimonies, there's a simple but effective rule of interpretation we need to understand. And Ellen White reiterated this, and it's published in Selected Messages, Book 1, page 57. She says, regarding the testimonies, nothing is ignored, nothing is cast aside, but time and place must be considered. Time and place must be considered. So to properly understand the testimonies, we have to know when they were written and the conditions around the writing of them. And with this in mind, let's notice some statements that condemn. Statements that condemn calling the Seventh-day Adventist Church Babylon or any part of Babylon. So here we go, because people need to know what these mean. This is from Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers, page 42 and 43, but it was first published in the Review and Herald, and I want to give you the date, August 29, 1893. That's important to remember, 1893. She says, to claim that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is Babylon is to make the same claim as does Satan. And friends, if that's all we had to hear, if that's all there was, that would be a fearful thing to think about, wouldn't it? But let's read on. To claim that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is Babylon is to make the same claim as does Satan, who is an accuser of the brethren, who accuses them before God night and day. By this misusing of the testimony, souls are placed in perplexity because they cannot understand the relation of the testimonies to such a position as is taken by those in error. For God intended that the testimonies should always have a setting in the framework of truth. And then she says, my brother, if you are teaching that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is Babylon, you are wrong. It's pretty plain, isn't it? You're wrong. God has not given you any such message to bear. Satan will use every mind to which he can attain access, inspiring men to originate false theories or to go off on some wrong tangent that he may create a false excitement and thus divert souls from the true issue for this time. Now again, that's from Testimonies to Ministers and Gospel Workers, page 59. But this was written from New Zealand and was first published in the Review and Herald of September 12th, 1893, that particular statement. And at the time of this testimony, there were some brethren in Australia who were declaring that the Adventist Church had become Babylon, and in fact they were using some of Ellen White's writings to supposedly substantiate it. Did they have a basis for saying such a thing at the time? And the answer simply is no. And in fact, Ellen White, not many months earlier, had written something about the state of the church, and I want you to notice what she wrote. Remember, that those two testimonies we just read were written in 1893, right? But I want you to notice what she wrote at the end of 1892, just a few months prior to that. She said, let everyone who claims to believe that the Lord is soon coming search the scriptures as never before. For Satan is determined to try every device possible to keep souls in darkness and blind the mind to the perils of the times in which we are living. Let every believer take up his Bible with earnest prayer that he may be enlightened by the Holy Spirit as to what is truth, and that he may know more of God and of Jesus Christ whom he has sent. Search for the truth as for hidden treasure and disappoint the enemy. And now notice these words, published in November 22 of 1892. She says this, the time of test is just upon us, for the loud cry of the third angel has already begun in the revelation of the righteousness of Christ, the sin-pardoning Redeemer. This is the beginning of the light of the angel whose glory shall fill the whole earth. For it is the work of everyone to whom the message of warning has come to lift up Jesus, to present him to the world as revealed in types, as shattered in symbols, as manifested in the revelations of the prophets, as unveiled in the lessons given to his disciples, and in the wonderful miracles wrought for the sons of men. Search the scriptures, for they are they that testify of him. And so at the time, at the very time people were proclaiming the Adventist Church was Babylon, God was starting to pour out his Holy Spirit. The latter rain was starting to fall. And she said it was through the revelation of the righteousness of Christ, the sin-pardoning Redeemer. This was because of the work that Ellen White joined in with Jones and Wagenron in preaching this loud cry. Now here we are, friends. We're 125 maybe years or so past that time. You know, it's not going to take 125 years for the loud cry to finish the work, is it? Of course not. We realize that this loud cry got cut off. But at the time Ellen White was writing the testimonies about the church not being part of Babylon, God was pouring out his Holy Spirit in a special way upon his people at that time. And there's no way that the church could properly be called Babylon at that time. But remember that we read a statement a little bit ago. It says, concerning the testimonies, nothing is to be ignored, nothing is to be set aside, but what must be considered? Time and place must be considered. Time and place. The question that we must deal with is how does God look upon the church today, in this time, and in this place, and have any things changed? Now, fundamental to the issue is an understanding of what is the church. In 1 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 15, Paul says, "But if I tarry long, that thou mayest know how thou oughtest to behave thyself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth." Paul says that above all things, the church is the pillar and ground of what?
The truth.
Truth. Could it be the pillar and ground of Babylonian doctrines? Of the central doctrine of the Catholic Church, even? I don't think so, do you? If fundamental truth is lacking, friends, no organization can truly be the church of the living God. Has there been a change in the position of the church on the most fundamental doctrine, the fundamental doctrine of God, from 1892 and 1893 till today?
That's right.
There has been a fundamental change. We have left off believing in the Father and Son. We begin believing in a triune or a Trinitarian God. So what is God's church today? An upward look on page 315. Ellen White says, God has a church. It is not the great cathedral. Neither is it the national establishment. Neither is it the various denominations. God's church is the people who love God and keep his commandments. Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Matthew 18:20. Where Christ is even among the humble few, this is Christ's church. For the presence of the high and holy one who inhabiteth eternity can alone constitute a church.
Amen.
When Ellen White wrote this, she was in Europe for the first time. And she saw things in Europe that she never saw in America, friends. She saw these great cathedrals. And she saw nations that had a state church. And she saw these things. It made an impression on her. She's writing to her sister back home. And she says, God's church is not a great cathedral. It's not the national establishment. It's the people who love God and keep his commandments. And Acts of the Apostles on page 11. She says, from the beginning, faithful souls have constituted the church on earth. Faithful souls. What does God say today? What does God say today? Will the church, who love God and keep his commandments, accept the central doctrine of Catholic faith, the Trinity? Will faithful souls throw away the sanctuary doctrine and find the atonement, the final atonement for an evangelical mess of no sanctification pottage?
No.
Will the pillar and ground of truth deny the one who is the way, the truth, and the life? I don't think so. Friends, the true remnant will keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Revelation 14:12, Revelation 12:17, you know those texts. They will be a people whose heart have God's law written within. God's law will be enshrined in their hearts. And the promises of Jeremiah were and are for a true people who love God and keep his commandments and have his law in their hearts. And those people will never be dispossessed from being his people. And this would have been true for Judah, Ellen White says, if they'd accepted Christ. And it would still be true for the corporate Adventism of today if they had not rejected Christ as the Son of God. But there's been a hijacking of a movement. Now, if I go to town and I see some kind of a liquor establishment, a bar, and over the top of the door post, they have a neon sign. And in bright, glowing colors, it says, Paradise. Does that make it paradise? Just because I call it that? Just because someone calls an organization the Seventh-day Adventist Church, does that make it the true Seventh-day Adventist Church? Friends, a profession without the reality is nothing. If I go to an Adventist church and I see the title remnant over it, that doesn't make it the remnant. Now let's go back to a basic point. The churches that fell from the favor of God in 1844, we were told, and we read these statements before, that they did not fall as far as they could have, nor did they even have the Sabbath question as a test at that time. Because there's still a falling that they're continuing to do. And their fall is not complete yet. In Ezekiel chapter 8, there are four abominations listed that God sees among his people. And this is clearly a vision for the last days. And one of the last of the four abominations that Ezekiel records is that the leaders of God's people have their backs to the temple and their faces to the east, worshiping the sun. Friends, this is wickedness. The worship of the sun is bad indeed, but they have their backs to the temple. They've rejected the sanctuary message. They've rejected sanctification. They are worshiping a false Christ because they are weeping for Tammuz. I'll ask you a question. You think about the Jewish people. You think about us today. Who's had the most truth revealed? Who's going to have the most responsibility? Amen. We will. If God, think about this, if God in 1844 could take the nominal churches that had never had the light on Sabbath, nor the sanctuary, and reject them, what will he do with the people who have had the light on the Sabbath and the sanctuary both, and yet reject them? Today, you know it, that there are sunrise, Sunday services in Adventism, in the churches. They have celebration services, ecumenical services. I saw a video of an Adventist church in France, and they had a Catholic priest speaking to the people. Mm-hmm. Adventist preacher on the platform, Baptist preacher on the platform, I think maybe a Methodist preacher, and the Catholic priest was the one who was speaking. And that's not such a rare thing. You know, you go back to the General Conference in Indianapolis, they actually had a Catholic bishop come up, I believe it was, and ask a blessing upon the conference. Can you imagine? Asking a representative of Lucifer to come and bless your people? It's crazy. It's crazy. The statement on the sanctuary and our current fundamental principles, but if you will examine that statement carefully, it sounds a lot like old-time Adventism, but it's not. It's straight out of Questions on Doctrine. We have denied the only true God and his Son. We have lightly regarded the Sabbath. We have neuro-linguistic programming and spiritualism entering our churches. How much more must happen before God has to apologize to the fallen churches in 1844? If he lets us go on with all this increased light, and yet those churches, he rejected them for so much less, he's got to apologize. Unless he doesn't change. Beloved, let's not be deluded nor hypnotized. Before we can teach others to come out of Babylon, we must come out of Babylon in all of her forms. The teaching that Babylon has fallen and to come out of her has never been nor ever will be a popular message. But friends, if we, by God's grace, have seen the brilliant light of truth, the light of the first angel's message and the light of the second angel's message, then we will be able to come out of Babylon, and then we will be able to preach the third angel's message. It's my prayer that each one of us will receive the light and the truth as it is in Jesus, and that we will worship him, and that he will be the head of our church, and not some man, and that the church is truly those who love God and keep his commandments, and not some corporation that's made a tie with the government. Because remember, Abraham had to come away from his country. And we have to get away from these corporations and these organizations that are tied in with the government's friends. We have to. And may God bless us to have the courage and the strength and the love that only he can give us to do that very thing. May God bless you lots and lots. Mm-hmm.